TTT Wrestling. My name is Toye Nice. I got Tim from Denmark, who's nice.
Hello, Toya from the US, who is not nice.
Right. And we're here to talk about Survivor Series, the result show.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was an interesting show.
A good show, right up until the very end.
I mean, that's Tim's opinion. But we'll talk about that later. Anyway, we're going to start for the first match, which was the women's War Games match.
Okay.
You had Bianca Belair, Charlotte Flair, Shotzi, and Becky Lynch against Damage Control, who was Bayley, Asuka, Kairi Sane, and the women's champ, Io Sky. So those of you who don't know how War Games works, I'll explain it to you. Basically, there's two people that will start for 5 minutes, and then the next person will come in, and after that third person, it'll be every 3 minutes. The match does not officially start till all 8 women are in the ring. Now you know how it goes. So the first two people that started was Bayley and Becky Lynch, and it was a good start.
Yeah, it was a really good start. Let me just say real quickly, I really like Shotzi's new look.
Yeah.
I don't know why, it just works for me. Apparently it's like a tribute to her sick sister or something. I'm not entirely sure, but I really liked it.
Yeah, that was good. I liked it. Yeah.
Bayley and Becky started out. The only thing I had really in the beginning, because both of them were, as usual, doing a great job. I could watch a singles match between those two any day. I think we all could. Corey is right. I know he's playing it up as a heel, but he's 100% right that compared to a lot of the other of the horsewomen, Bayley doesn't get enough respect for what she has done.
Oh, that's true. That is definitely true. I actually have more to say about that, but I'll probably say that toward the end of this segment.
Yeah, but, yeah, that's fine. Again, I just had it on my notes, so I wanted to get it out.
So then Dakota Kai got involved with the Kindlestick to Becky's back. She wasn't in the ring because she's injured, but she was just, you know,
able to be
around the ring. Like, it's good
it's
to
nice
see her.
To see she's still. It's nice to see she's capable of being physically active again. Like, even to the degree she is. That hopefully means she can get back in the ring sooner rather than later.
I totally, utterly agree. So then the next person, what was it? Shotzi came in?
That was Shotzi, yes.
Yeah, and then she came in with,
I actually have my notes right now.
She came in with, I think, bunch of chairs, you know, just brought in chairs and I think a trash can at the time, and you know, to
which is actually a good way of doing it, like starting out a War Games with actual wrestling,
right?
And then when more and more people starts going in, start the semi illegal stuff. That's usually a good way of structuring it, in my opinion.
Because then Chelsea came in, and then Io Sky came in with the chain. And I was like, when is that chain gonna come in through? I was wondering.
Yeah,
we'll talk about that later. And then it was like, what? Who was it? Freaking, who came in next? I think Kairi Sane. And then...
Can't remember. I didn't take notes, to be honest.
Okay, well, Kairi. And then it was Shots. No, I think it was...
I think it was Charlotte as number three for the... Yeah, it was, because Bianca came last.
Yeah,
for
Bianca came
for the
last.
Faces.
And then Asuka came on for her team. But anyway, so go ahead. And then finally, the match finally started. I mean, the match was just unbelievably good. Like, it gave me a heart attack. I was, like, in anxiety. I was like, oh my god, this is going... It's like, it was so much going on. But it was, like, good. It was just, like, okay, Becky, when Bianca Burke came in, you could just hear her, she had, like, two braids in her head. She was just whipping everybody with her hair and everything, and it's, like, and then at that one point, Io Sky was, like, on top of the cage. I'm, like, Io, what are you doing? Get down from there. You're gonna hurt yourself. Just landing on everybody, and I was just, like, oh, my gosh, I can't watch this anymore. This gives me a heart attack.
Yeah.
Charlotte
Oh, the trash can jump was glorious. That was so funny. The chained up, like the chained up quadruple drop kick was super cool.
Oh yeah, it was a lot of good stuff that went on in this match that I really enjoyed. But yeah, what else happened?
They had that weird situation where I think it was Becky and Charlotte were having one of those, and we're on the same team, but we don't like each other stare downs. And Io Sky does like a scream and runs behind Becky and pushes her into Charlotte. And I was like, okay, you knew that was coming. You were just standing still watching her run around you guys. Come on, that was silly. It was fun, but it was silly.
Yeah, eventually they ended up hugging it out and everything, so...
Yeah. The only criticism, like, for any spot I have was just after they did the thing with the top cage inside a trash can jump, Charlotte went up as well. And the thing is, first of all, that came too soon after the other spot, in my opinion. It looked it more or less looked like Charlotte was like, well, if he can do it, I can do it. When she then did the jump, it was obvious that everyone else was just standing around to receive her. When we had the trash can jump, people were fighting downstairs and only turned to receive the fall at the last moment. Charlotte would just jump down to a bunch of people looking at her. It just fell flat, in my opinion, which is really sad because top cage jumps are not easy to do, I would think.
I mean, I didn't think it was so bad, but yeah, I guess.
It wasn't bad. It was just, if I have criticism, that would be the criticism.
But yeah, then, I think they won, Becky's team won by, having Becky do the man slam on, Bayley, on a table.
Yep.
And so, yeah, I think, I don't know the whole point of this match was in the beginning, because it was, like, talking about, you know, having beef with, Damage Control.
Yeah.
We already had this, right? I mean, at least Becky and Bianca did. I can understand Charlotte Flair and Shotzi having their, like, beef with Damage Control, but, like...
Yeah.
And if it was just to put, like, Becky and Charlotte, you know, as friends again, that's kind of silly. So I'm just thinking, I'm guessing that this is some kind of segue that's gonna have Bayley either get kicked out of Damage Control or be faced again. I have no idea. Because I don't really see a point. I mean, it was a good match.
No, I agree with you. I agree with you. It's it looks very... It looked very, very strange.
Right.
And is it what it, or it sense. Felt very, very strange, is right. What it felt like.
So, I mean, it was a very good match and everything like that, but it's like, if that don't happen, like, by tomorrow or, like, next Friday or something, I have no idea. Like, I don't know what's gonna happen. But, I mean, she did get pinned, and so, who knows? We'll see tomorrow, but yeah. But.
Yeah, we'll see tomorrow. We'll see tomorrow. Again, it was just, the whole thing felt a bit, like I said last week in the prediction show, this felt like, more than anything, this felt like a setup for the next feud for Io. Probably with Bianca, to be honest, again. And it's just, I don't know what's going to happen, but the whole match felt pointless. You're right about that. I mean, for a story perspective, again, from a match perspective, it was super, super cool.
I mean, from the match itself, it's great. It was a good-ass match. It's probably my favorite match of the night. But from a story perspective, it was just like, okay, I don't really understand and get it.
No, exactly. Like,
okay, sure.
I don't know why this match was there.
I'm just thinking it's going to be a Bayley versus, like, a Damage Control match thing going on.
Yeah, probably going to be a Bayley
she'll go back to with the four horse women, well, three, I guess, whatever. Who knows? And have, like, I don't know.
I mean, I we'll guess. See. I guess Bianca is the new fourth horsewoman now. I don't know. She is the black girl in the bunch, after all.
Is she black?
I don't know. Is she? I don't even know.
Did not know. Surprise! Bianca's black! Anyways.
I guess.
Let's go to
She is the blackest of WWE, after all.
Well, here's some good, exciting news. R-Truth is back. Yay! Had a little segment.
Yeah, that was awesome! R-Truth. Oh, God, I was so happy to see him again. That was, like, the best return of the evening. And there were some returns this evening.
Yes. But, yeah, he was up there, and he was like, where have you been? And I think it had, like, the Pretty Deadly was there, and the Alpha Academy. It was, like, some kind of segment for some ruffled chips or crisps or whatever and stuff like that. He's like, they're not chips. They're not Chris, they're Ruffles! And then it was like funny. I'm glad to see him back. And I'm excited.
Truth is still the best thing going, just from a comedy perspective.
Yes, totally. I totally agree. But let's actually get to a match. We had the Intercontinental match with Gunther versus The Miz.
Yeah.
It was a pretty decent match. Miz looked good.
It was a really good match. Miz, like, it was nice to see Miz as a serious competitor again.
Yes.
It was nice to see Miz as a serious competitor again. And since he was back as a serious competitor, he showed what he can really do. Because no one does, but I think to a certain degree there might... Sorry, what?
No, go ahead.
I think there is a certain tendency to forget just how good Miz is because there is so long between his serious matches, right?
Right.
So I think people sometimes have a tendency to just equate Miz to the semi-comedy, reality star, even though we know all of us know better. Sometimes it can be. But again, Gunther has not had a bad match in, very, very long. Miz, just at the peak of his game, is just really, really good. I could not imagine this being a bad match, and it really wasn't. It was a really good match. It had the same problem that all of the all of the non-giving matches have on a show like this and on a show like the Rumble. I don't have a solution to this, because I don't think there is a solution. We should just be happy getting a good match despite of it. But because the gimmick matches, both at the Rumble and at War Games Survivor Series, needs to take up the time they take, the other matches, the regular matches, simply don't get as much time as they probably would on some other shows, and probably should. It was the same thing you saw with the Luchador match later in the evening. Like, just as it was starting to pick up pace, it had to end to keep the time frame. And I think that was the same thing with the Intercontinental title match. It was a really good match, but it could have been a great match if they had another 7-8 minutes.
Those 7-8 minutes matter, guys. But yeah, Gunther retained his title.
He did? We kind of knew he would.
Yes, he probably should have. Yeah. But yeah, you know, at one point, Miz did try to cheat. Didn't work out for him, but you know.
No. Again, Miz looked really good. He got he kicked out of one of Gunther's finishing moves. He got he got his finisher in on Gunther. He just looked really good.
Yeah.
I'm just really happy to see that. I never thought Miz would win. But I'm just happy to see him look really, really good.
I'm looking forward to like more matches like that from The Miz.
Yeah, exactly. Like, go back, do some more stuff, dude. Because I missed it.
Totally.
Yeah,
really. So yeah. To say about this match?
Nope, not really.
Me neither. Good. Okay, let's go to the next one, shall we?
Yeah.
We'll go to the one. Santos Escobar versus Dragon Lee. So, on Friday's SmackDown, Carlito got injured and Dragon Lee took his place. So,
yeah.
That's what happened.
Yeah. And I was super excited about... Well, I wasn't. Because I was excited to see Carlito back, but I understand why they did it for storyline purposes. But I was really excited to see this, because Santos Escobar and Dragon Lee are probably two of the best luchadors working in the world right now. Especially out of Mexico. They're just both really, really good. This is why it bugged me that they didn't even have 8 minutes for their match, because... Oh man, I could see these two having a banger. This was another really good match, but it wasn't a great match.
Yeah. It was a decent match. It wasn't like, oh wow, look at all this spectacular stuff that's going on in this match, and I will remember it forever. It's like, no.
No, exactly. This is a match that could just as well have been had on SmackDown.
I mean, also, this was like a match that people didn't even get, like, a chance to be, like, excited for, because it was, like...
Yeah, this, it came out the last minute.
It was, like, oh, okay. Yeah. I was thinking Carlito, and then I'm, like, I'm getting Dragon Lee. Not that I don't like Dragon Lee, he's good and everything.
No. Like I said, Dragon Lee is great from a technical perspective.
He's
one of the very best.
Yeah.
Like, he's super good. Santos Escobar is super good. But, again, this just felt like... This felt like a match they could have had on SmackDown without taking anything away from this card.
I think it would have been better if it was a little bit longer, because towards the end it was getting like real good, but it was like, oh wait, we have a time frame coming up, you know, stuff like that. But like, I think if it was a little bit longer, he did a little bit more tricks and stuff like that, Dragon Lee or whatever, it would probably been a lot better. But like I said, yeah. it was an okay match. I'm not like saying it was a bad match or it was like the worst match. Oh, worst match.
It was a fun match. They're both really, really good, and they did their best with what they had. Again, it was just this. It didn't feel like a pay-per-view match. Oh, sorry, a premier live event match.
Yes. That.
Sorry, you're not allowed to say pay-per-view anymore.
So yeah, that. But Escobar won. Like we said, he should, because, you know, he's the heel, and if they want to start this, especially if the storyline's going this way, yeah.
Yeah, no. Santos Escobar needed to win this one. Like,
definitely.
If they want LWO to go on, and God, I hope they do, but if they want LWO to go on, then Santos Escobar needs to win this match, and then he needs to lose to Carlito or Rey Mysterio.
Fuck Rey Mysterio, got it.
Fuck Rey Mysterio. Yeah, who cares about Rey Mysterio? Has never done anything in wrestling.
Exactly. Fucking loser. No, it's kidding. He's great. Yeah. Anyways, but yeah, I thought it was a good match, and that's all I have to say. Anything else?
Nope. I'm good with this. Like I said, way too short. That was my best comment on this one.
Alright, so we got the Women's World Championship match. Rhea Ripley defended her title against Zoe Stark.
Just like the first one, this felt kind of pointless, because I don't think anyone thought Zoe Stark could win it.
I don't think so either.
Like, I mean, she did really good.
Yeah.
It was a fun match. Both of them put on a show.
If the whole point was just to make Zoe Stark look good, job done.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You know? While keeping the title on Rhea. If that was the point, they did their job and it was fine. I have nothing bad to say about this match. I also just don't have any real thing to say about that beyond. It was fine.
It was a good match. It's been pretty much real matches of late. She won clean, so
yeah
that's good.
this is the thing where I'm again, they either need to take the title off Rhea, or they need to play it up within the Judgment Day storyline, because right now with Rhea Ripley it feels like she's part of two entirely separate things. She is like the heart and probably even the leader of Judgment Day, and she's also the women's champion. But the two things don't connect in any way, and it's very weird.
Yes, it is.
They are probably just waiting until they can have a Rhea versus someone match at either the Rumble or Mania. But it still feels very disconnected.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know what's going on. I mean, it looks like, from what I've been noticing, it might be her next competitor might be Nia Jax. Not sure.
Yep.
So we'll see about that. But yeah, I don't really know what's going on. Like, I don't think she needs the title if she's
No, that's the thing. She really, but at the same time, it's Rhea Ripley.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm happy with her having the title. I just need to figure out what they are doing with her.
Right.
Something.
I agree. I don't know what they're doing with her or what they want to do with her. I have no idea. But, you know, we'll see. We'll see what happens. But, yeah, she won, obviously. And so I have no more to say about this match.
Exactly.
It's short and sweet. Match of the night, which was the Men's War Games. We had Cody Rhodes, Jey Uso, Seth Rollins, yep, and Sami Zayn, and a missing Randy Orton. And during this time, there was a bunch of segments saying, because Randy Orton wasn't there yet, and they were like, where's Randy Orton at? Jey Uso was flaming himself, saying he ain't gonna show up because of me and everything else. So yeah, so basically, yeah, at the time they played it up a lot. They played it up too much. It was like, yeah, okay,
that's what I think.
We get it. Okay,
he's not gonna show up.
We got it. Yeah. Wink, wink.
Can I say who they're first? Oh, sorry, I forgot. Yes.
Versus Drew McIntyre, who was teaming up with the Judgment Day, Senor Briefcase,
Money in the Bank.
Damian Priest, Finn Balor, Dominic Mysterio, and JD Madonna, and yeah. Go ahead.
JD is now an official member of Judgment Day.
JD is the member of the official member of Judgment Day, but he's like the one that gets all the brutes and the brunts of everything.
Yeah. Let JD do it. When he became the official member after the whole thing, but it's fine. He is now a member of the Judgment Day. It's all good.
A couple of weeks ago.
See, this is where I differ from Toya, because as good as the women's match was, I think this one was better. Again, that's just how it is. That's just my opinion of it. I'm sure she's going to tear me apart when this is over. I have of my notes the suicide dive in the start where Seth just came in, stared down Finn Balor, those two started, and then just suicide dived over the like middle ropes of the two rings connected was really fun. After that, I don't actually have a lot of notes on this one because I was too invested in the match. It was that good. When I don't take notes from a match, that's usually when it's really, really good because I forget.
Right, nothing. Yeah, it was a good match. You know, everyone had their spots and everything. And at that last, Cody Rhodes was like the second to the last person. And then they were like, basically it was like a 5-on-4 at one point. And then some music hit, and Rhea had like, Damian Priest's suitcase and was about to, cash in for, Priest, and then you hear Randy Orton's music comes, and like the crowd just went crazy. Yeah.
The roof blew up. The roof blew off the building.
Yes.
Randy has been missed.
Sure, he sure has. And then they finally started the actual match and everything else.
Yep.
It was a good match. My favorite thing. I have a couple of favorites.
The ending, like. The ending was spectacular, by the way.
I have a couple of favorites. But, yeah, like the 5-on-5 DDT, like the Randy Orton DDT thing, that was pretty cool. The thing where it had like, okay, so like Randy Orton at one point turned to Jey Uso like he's about to RKO him, and then they didn't add cardio, and then Jey Uso, like, cause Priest was about to attack Randy Orton, Jey Uso super kicked Priest, and then Randy Orton RKO'd Dominic. There was a hula kick, there was a stomp, there was Uso splash, like, and all back and back and back and back.
Everyone hit their finishes.
Right, and I'm just like, oh, that was cool. And then poor JD.
Oh, man. At the same time, that's one that'll be remembered, right?
Right. I'm like, so JD JD was the only one that was left. And he got up and he, like, looked at everybody and he was, like, trying to escape from the ring. Now, mind you, you cannot escape, because if you escape, this is not, like, a cage match. You can't escape. If you escape it, you forfeit the match. So, the match. I mean,
at that point, he was like, oh, screw that. I'm out. I'm gone, dude.
Like, forget this. And then, like, Jey and family went up for them, right? And then, like, they had him up on top of the cage, and Randy Orton's like, basically, like, just bring him down here, like, throw him down here, and they threw him on the thing in an RKO. I'm like, oh my god, poor JD.
So cool.
It was cool, but I mean, I felt so bad.
Yeah, I was like, oh shit, Randy hit him so close to the floor.
Oh, I know.
I was like, oh shit, he's going to miss it, he's going to miss it, he's going to miss it. Oh, he got him.
Okay,
like,
got him.
It was just around the floor.
And then, I think the guy, like, I think he did an RKO and then gave the, to Priest and then gave the, to Cody Rhodes. And then Cody Rhodes did the crossroads. And then,
let's call it a crosscutter. Yeah, that's actually a really good name. Someone should use that for a finisher. Like, it could be like a mix of the crossroads and the diamond cutter. Sure. I don't know how it would work, but I'm sure it would be cool.
And then you got the pin, so that was cool and everything else. But
to be fair, a diamond cutter is basically just an RKO. So he was hit with a crosscutter. He was hit with both of them. So it's fine.
Totally. But it was a good match. I mean, I liked that match. It was one of one of my favorite matches. Like the war game matches very rarely
disappoint. War game matches are one of my oldest favorites.
And it's cool to see Cody Rhodes in one of his dad's matches. There was this one point I forgot to mention, that there was this one point where they brought that like little cowbells rope thing, and then they had it in between Cody Rhodes and Seth Rollins had it in between Finn Balor's legs, and I'm like, oh no, not the bells, the balls! The bells, the balls! Oh god, poor Finn.
I really hope that Finn was remembering his cup tonight, because that looked bad. That looked almost as bad as the crotch kick that Miz gave Gunther earlier.
Yeah, I was just like, not the bells to the balls.
Ow. No, it was super good. It was the right ending as well. That was a match. As the thing developed, that was a match that the faces needed to win.
Yeah, definitely. Should like kind of like just end it with like Desmond Dane. I can go on with other things and stuff like that, and like Desmond Dane can do whatever the hell it is they're going to be doing. I don't know.
Yep, I don't know either, but something. I'm sure they'll figure out something.
But yeah, and then at the end of the night, Tim's favorite wrestler ever comes out. We're in Chicago, we have a return. CM Punk is back in the WWE. So I'm going to give Tim a moment to go ahead and rant. Go ahead.
I don't have a rant. Like, listen, let me start with the positive. Bringing CM Punk back in Chicago was unquestionably one of the smartest short-term decisions WWE has made in years and years and years and years. We have talked about before that one of the things WWE has had a problem with the last couple of years, because of the eternal domination of Roman, has been the concept of sending fans home happy. After this War Game match, and then having Punk come out, there is absolutely no question that the fans, especially in Chicago, went home happy, more happy than they have in a very, very long time. Here's the thing. I hate CM Punk. He seems to me to be one of the most horribly, horribly toxic, self-righteous, hypocritical assholes in professional wrestling. And he, everywhere he has been, he has left with the locker room morale in shambles and slammed the door on his way out being a complete asshole. Now, some might say, oh, he's changed, this is his last chance, if he doesn't do it here, there's nowhere else. I just don't see it, because he did it in AEW just 3 months ago. It's just, I just don't see good things from this. I mean, apparently both Seth and Drew are super pissed over it. Drew stormed out and is apparently leaving the company over it. I would rather have Drew McIntyre than I would have CM Punk. But that's me. That's like, I can't deny the man's talent. But damn, I don't like him as a person. It's even worse than Logan Paul. Maybe those two can fight. Then we can at least sort of, you know, separate them off for themselves.
All right.
There, I'm done.
Okay.
You can stop laughing now.
I'm going to say something now. I don't care.
Yes.
I don't care if he's I don't give a shit if he's an asshole, because you know what? There's a lot of wrestlers who are fucking assholes. I don't give a shit. That's not my problem. I come in for the entertainment and for the wrestling and stuff like that. I mean, look, I'd have my problems with CM Punk, but I don't think that Triple H would bring him in knowing what he knows. I don't think Triple H is that stupid of a business person, personally. I don't think so. And the only thing I could do is wait and see what happens. Right? I don't
know.
It's even like with like Logan Paul. I don't have nothing personal with him. Or kind of like, but Logan Paul is a little bit different because I know him from a different era, a different thing that he used to do before he got into sports entertainment and stuff like that. But I would like to see a match between him and CM Punk. That'd be great. But like, I don't know. Like you said, you can't deny the man's talent. You can't deny he's a great wrestler. And I don't know. Maybe he just wasn't fucking happy in AEW, and he might be more happier in WWE. I have no idea. Like I'm saying, I'm just gonna give a shot. I'm not gonna put him down. I'm gonna see what happens. It's like I was like, say the first time Logan. I'm like, I'm just Logan Paul. Like, let's just see what he does. See what happens.
Listen,
I'm not going to. I'm not going to, like, say anything until, you know, maybe a couple of months in when he's, you know, it does something or whatever. I mean, if it's good enough, if it's good for the company and it gets seats and it gets different storylines and it gets all the other stuff that we've been bitching and complaining about, the storylines and everything else, if it changes the storylines and makes everything, like, different and, like, whatever, I'm all for it. As far as, like, people being angry about it, like, Seth Rollins and Drew McIntyre, well, you know what, yeah, you can leave, that's fine. You can run if you want to, or you can just go ahead and fight him. Prove him wrong.
But I can't do anything. I hope I can be proved wrong. God, I hope I will be proved wrong.
I mean, again, like I said, I can do is look at a man's history,
and his man's history is not very good. That's all I will say.
I mean, you know, he said he's changed, so let's see. Let's just give him a chance and see what happens. I'm not going to be like, oh, well, fuck him because he did this, he did that.
If he's the one to take the title of Roman, I quit.
I mean, that's fine. I mean, I at this point, we need a person that actually is a working champion. We don't have one. We have two part-time champions on SmackDown and one working champion on SmackDown right now. And the only working champion right now is Io Sky. Who we got? Logan Paul, who's not hardly ever there. And we have Roman, who's hardly ever there. If CM Punk is there every goddamn day and he's putting in seats and he's doing his work, why would I be mad about that? Because he said some mean
stuff. We shall see. I'm just not super optimistic about it.
I mean, that's fine. You don't have to be. I will. I'll just be open. Good. But yeah. Anyways,
good,
guys.
Good.
That was 10 Tangent. Da da da. Anyways, that is it. That was the last match of the year. There'll be nothing in December, so we'll see what we do.
I think isn't there another thing in Saudi Arabia? Haven't they like aren't they doing another thing in Saudi Arabia or something? I don't even know. But there is no official premium live event in December. No. So the next time will be the start of the road to WrestleMania, the Royal Rumble.
Yay! Which we already know that Cody Rhodes said he was going to be in it. But yeah, I'm excited.
Yeah.
I'm actually...
I'm looking forward to it. Yeah. I'm always looking forward to the Rumble. It's still my favorite. It's still my favorite, like... it's not necessarily the best of the year, but it's always my favorite show of the year before, like, we start.
It's definitely a good start. But anyways, that is it, guys. Enjoy your Thursday. We'll see you guys whenever we see you guys. Okay, bye!